I do all, I am Cosimo Vinci. The work I'm presenting is titled Data-Driven Models of Selfish Routing: Why Prasovana Key Does Depend on Network Topology. This is a joint work with Francisco Benita, who will give the second part of this talk, Vittorio Bilò, Banave Monno, and Georgios Pilioras. In this work, we propose and analyze a new model for describing selfish routing to give a more realistic analysis of the traffic inefficiency in real-world networks, where the traffic is caused by the collective behavior of the selfish drivers. And we also experimentally validate our model. I will start with the theoretical part of the work, and then Francisco will describe the experimental one. So, the traffic inefficiency, as usual in algorithmic game theory, is measured by the metric of price of anarchy, defined as the worst-case ratio between the social cost of the highest cost equilibrium configuration divided for the optimal social cost. In the context of traffic, the equilibrium is a configuration that is stable and in which each agent chooses her best path regardless of the traveling time of the other drivers. Instead, the social optimum is a configuration in which that globally minimizes the expected traveling time of all the drivers. From previous work, we have that when the latencies, which express the cost, so the traveling time of each road as a function of the drivers covering it, when the latencies are affine functions, the price of anarchy is at most four-third. Instead, when latency functions are quartic polynomials, this function is quite important as it is defined in the standard Bureau of Public Roads cost model to describe real-world latencies. So, in this case, the price of anarchy is at most 2.15. We ask if the previous upper bounds are tight. At least in theory, yes. Indeed, simple Pigou-like networks match the previous upper bounds. And such networks are made of two links connecting a source and a destination, and in the case of quartic latency functions, we have that the first link has a cost of one, constant cost that does not depend on the congestion, and the lower link has a cost that increases as a monomial of degree four with respect to the congestion. So, in this case, the equilibrium is when all the agents choose, so we have a unitary amount of drivers, and the equilibrium is when all the drivers choose the lower link. Instead, the optimal configuration is when some drivers choose the upper link and some drivers choose the lower link. This network will be the worst case. The worst case efficient inefficient the worst case efficiency of traffic in real world in networks. But is it the same in real world networks? We have that some experiments have empirically shown that the price of anarchy is really close to one in real world networks. Thus, we can argue that, so we can say that Pigou-like networks are probably unlikely to be real-world networks. Thus, in this case, we should need more appropriate selfish routing models. Probably one reason is that in real-world scenarios, the drivers never choose a path whose length that is the sum of the constant times in the latency functions of the considered path is too far from the minimum path length. For instance, it is reasonable assuming that if the shortest path that does not take into account the congestion or the traffic, just the length, if the shortest path between one source and one destination is one, No driver whose shoes a path having a length of 10, independently from the traffic. So, more formally, let 1 plus theta be the maximum ratio between the length of any possible path and the optimal path length. In this work, we have empirically shown that for theta is more or less equal to 1 in a city like Singapore. Francisco will give further details about this in the second part of the talk. Instead, for the theoretical PQ-like network depicted previously, we have that theta is equal to infinite. Thus, probably, this theta is the missing parameter that we should incorporate in our routing model to better describe the traffic inefficiency. And this observation has led us to define the new routing model of theta free flow congestion games. At Apple, we start with the model of congestion games. What is a non-atomic congestion game? Non-atomic congestion game is formally a tuple made of a set of types of players and a value ri denoting the amount of players of type I. The players are the drivers in the context of traffic, and ri describe for any source and destination how many drivers want to start from that source to arrive in that destination. E is a finite set of resources modeling the roads of the street of the road network, and sigma I for any I is the set of strategies for players I, for players of type I, that is the set of path connecting the source to the destination. A strategy profile sigma is a configuration in which each player has chosen a strategy. Each player of type I, selecting a strategy S in strategy profile sigma, incurs a cost that is the sum of all the resources belonging to the strategies of the cost experienced on all the resources, that is given by the latency function, that is a non-decreasing and positive function, applied to the congestion of that resource, that is the total amount of players selecting that resource. Now we can move to the model of theta free flow congestion games. A theta free flow congestion game is simply a congestion game that verifies the following property, that is, for any pair of strategies, so all the strategies available to players of type I, when evaluated in absence of congestion, are within a factor 1 plus theta, one from the other. So, given to strategy S and S prime, if we sum all the latencies, the cost of strategy S, but by imposing a congestion equal to zero to each resource, is at most 1 plus theta multiplied for the same quantity applied to strategy S prime. For instance, if theta is equal to 1, the first network is not theta free flow, that is the network we considered before, the PQ-like network considered before. Indeed, for such network, if we compare the cost without evaluated in absence of congestion for the first link and the cost evaluated in absence of congestion for the second link, so the first one is 1, the second one is 0. So 1 over 0 is infinite. So it is a theta, for theta equal to infinite, okay, this is theta free flow, but not for theta equal to 1. Instead, by using the same arguments, one can easily show that the second network, as you can easily observe, is theta free flow for theta equal to 1. Indeed, the previous ratio is equal to 1 divided by 0.5, that is equal to 2, so it is 2 minus 1 free flow game, that is 1 free flow game. Now we move to the analysis of the price of anarchy, to the problem of quantifying the price of anarchy of free flow congestion games. So, The price of anarchy, as I said before, is defined as the ratio between the total cost of the worst case equilibrium, where the total cost is given by the sum of all the players' costs, divided for the optimal total cost. So, and we consider the highest ratio between these two quantities. As a first result, we have obtained that for any theta higher or equal than zero, we get tight bounds for the price of anarchy of theta free flow congestion games with very general latency functions. Indeed, the latency functions we consider are require very simple properties like continuity. And under this hypothesis, we provide the closed form bounds for the price of anarchy, which are tight even for games with singleton strategies. Furthermore, for homogeneous latency functions, our bounds are also tight for parallel link networks, which are games with singleton strategies, but in which each agent can select all the singletons. And this solves an open problem posed by Rough Garden, in which the open problem was asking if there was a characterization of the price of anarchy for this kind of latency functions. Then we have applied the previous results to get tight bounds, explicit bounds, for the price of anarchy of polynomial latency functions with minimum non-zero degree Q and maximum degree P, which are of common interest. Now, an interesting property exhibited by our model is the following. For general non-atomic congestion games, the tight bound for the price of anarchy is matched by simple two parallel link games. But is this always true for theta free flow congestion games? So the previous results has been shown by Rough Garden 2003. But we ask, is this always true for our model? The answer is no. Indeed, when moving from general strategies to parallel link strategies, the price of anarchy generally decreases. Indeed, we can observe from these graphics that this fact is true for quartic latency functions of type alpha x to the 4 plus beta. In these graphics, we have the price of anarchy as functions of theta, and the first function, the lowest one, refers to parallel link, and the other one refers to general theta free flow games. Then we have also this constant line that refers to the price of anarchy of general congestion games, that is when theta is equal to infinite. So, for instance, for one, that is, that should be the value of theta describing real world networks according to our experimental findings. So, we can observe that there is a nice difference between. There is a difference between the price of anarchy of general congestion games, that is almost 2.2, with the price of anarchy of theta free flow games, that is between 1.6 and 1.7. Instead, for parallel link networks, we have an even lower bound on the price of anarchy, that is 1.3. And I will mention that for any theta, such bounds are tight. Now I will conclude my part by giving an overview of the price of anarchy values for polynomials. Here there are the price of anarchy values of free flow games with polynomial latency functions of maximum degree P at most 4 and minimum degree Q for all the possible combinations. And one can observe that the price of anarchy depends on the network topology if theta is in the middle between 0 and infinite. Indeed, for theta equal to 0 and theta equal to infinite, the value does not change when moving from general strategies to parallel link. Instead, for theta equal to 1/2 and theta equal to 1, we have the difference, we have some differences. And we can observe, as in the previous case of quartic functions, also in the other case, we have that the price of anarchy for theta equal to 1/2 is lower than that for theta equal to 1, that is lower than theta equal to infinite. And I would also remark that tight bounds, we have given tight bounds for homogeneous polynomials that can be obtained by setting theta equal to 0 in these values. These bounds have been obtained as upper bounds in a previous work, but there were no tight lower bounds in such work. Okay, now Francisco will describe the experimental part of this work. Thanks for your kind attention.
Thank you, Cosimo. For the experimental part, what we did is we look at real-world mobility datasets. In 2016 in Singapore, we conducted an experiment with more than 80,000 students, in which every single student wore one sensor. And this sensor was able to record the location of each student every 13 seconds. So by looking at all these row location points, we were able to track the students at different times of the day, in different days of the week. After processing this huge amount of row data points, we derive origin-destination pairs, meaning home-school trips. And for every home-school trip, we were able to see from how far students are traveling from, how long is taking them to reach the school, and which mode of transportation they are using, whether they are taking private car or public transport. In this figure in the right-hand side, is one example of just one school, and we can see how different students from different parts of the east side of the city, they are commuting to just one school, represented in the yellow hotspot. And to have an idea of the size of the problem we are looking at, Singapore is about 1/2 of the size of London. For the theta free flow time in Singapore, we did that in two steps. First, by looking at the raw data points of how students were moving, we were able to reconstruct which path they are taking. For example, in this figure, the red dots represents the locations recorded by the sensor. And after processing these points, we map by using the road street network, we were able to identify which path they are selecting to commute from home to school. So this path is called the data path, and the data path has attached a latency, which is the travel time. So to compute the travel time, we use the speed limits of the road street network in the city. On the other hand, we also compute what we call the free flow path, represented in this yellow color. So the free flow path is the shortest path for each origin destination pair. Here again, this shortest path will depend on the speed limits of the road street network. So by looking at the difference of these two latencies, for example, the latency of the data path here is 21 minutes, 19 seconds, and the latency of the free flow path is 13 minutes, 55 seconds. So by looking at this difference in time between the two paths, the chosen path and the free flow path, we could somehow estimate theta, which is how far the students are from the shortest path. Next, this figure is just to show you the size of the problem we were working with. So links in pink color represent streets that students are taking for their daily commutes. And links in gray color represent links that students are not using. They correspond to industrial areas, for example, where students don't go to such areas. So as you can see from the figure, we were able to map many paths along the city, and they are well distributed around the city. And the set of trips we were working consisted of more than 60,000 students because we have to remove students that were walking to school or students who were taking public transport to school. And the number of trips we were working with was more of 34,000. So to estimate theta, again, we compute this ratio, the ratio between the data path, the latency of the data path, and the latency of the free flow path. So by looking at this ratio, which we can call also deviation, we can see how far are our students from the shortest path. And by plotting the distribution of these values of theta for every trip, because for every trip we compute theta, we can reconstruct this figure that you can see in here. So in this figure, the message is for 80% of the trips, the deviation is less or equal than one. So that means like in 80% of the cases, students are taking paths that are at most 2 times larger than the shortest path. So just to conclude, the main takeaways of our work, we have introduced a new class of theta free flow routing games. These theta free flow routing games, they capture the behavior of real world networks, and they have a strong assumption on the latencies, on the edge costs. But this strong assumption is supported by empirical data. And with that, we were able to compute a much tighter bounds of the price of anarchy. So we also have shown that the price of anarchy in theta free flow routing games, they do depend on the network topology. And we would like to conclude with an analogy of our contribution. So imagine that you would like to study the anatomy of the human body, which is very complex. So because it's very complex, we start with a simple model, with a simplification, and we become an expert of the simple model. But at some point, we look back at the reality or at the real problem we wanted to investigate, and we realize that we are very far away from the reality. So with this work, we would like to try to capture in a more real way the reality of the problem. So here again, if you would like to understand real routing games, how the routing behavior is happening in cities, so we need more than simple PIGU models. We need something that actually captures the reality. And by that, we need to look at empirical data. And from the empirical data, we can propose new theoretical models. Thank you very much for your attention.